What's up, guys? I am Jamie Bedingfield. You are listening to my podcast, Too Many Words. Welcome to the show. I have a wonderful conversation with the lovely and wildly talented Fran Wild today. And if you are not familiar with her words and worlds, I suggest you do so. She is hands down one of my favorite writers. So it was a real pleasure to chat with her. And that conversation will be up for you guys in a short bit. I won't make you wait too long. So how's it going? What's new? What's in the works? Thanksgiving has passed. November is gone. It's one of those months that it doesn't stick around. Over the years, Christmas has eaten up part of it, and the fall is always just pure madness. So here we are, edging towards the end of the year, the end of 2017, the place and time where autumn transforms into winter, which, you know, honestly, I enjoy dark at 4 o'clock and the ever cover of clouds and moist ground and bright green evergreens. Said green a couple of times there. My words just always flow more at this time of year, and chill is in the air, and tea with too much honey, candles and notebooks and slippers. It works, guys. NaNoWriMo has come to an end, or almost is, depending on when you are listening to me. Patreon supporters get it early, so if you know it's Tuesday, it's nearing the end. Anyway, I really like NaNoWriMo because there's something just comforting about just the mass goals and writers of all levels and, you know, of their career working towards coming to the same goal, to reach 50,000 words. And I crossed over 52,010 words last night in my rewrite. And the one that, you know, the rewrite that grew furry legs and sharp talons as it lurked in the corner, urging me to tackle it. And I'm reaching the midpoint now, and I'm just so happy to be in it and doing what needs to be done, really. And I'm just having so much fun doing it, which has been my main focus, to have fun, to write the story because the characters need me to. Something for me, and you know, just light a whole bunch of candles, play a new playlist, fold into the world, feel it day to day. You know, my word count changed, you know, and some of my words were just me working out details or playing with scenes, with characters' needs and faults and hopes. And I've been looking at a lot of art, and Pinterest is such an awesome resource if you need a little creative jolt, especially for fantasy and science fiction writers. There is just a chasm of breathtaking images, and, you know, it's dreamers helping dreamers. So, and as we enter December, it's still pretty much NaNo for me. I'm going to continue with this momentum. I'm going to tread this rewrite as if it were the epic adventure it's about, which it is. And something to keep in mind as you leave NaNoWriMo, reaching your goal or not, that this has been just a month, a capsule of effort and learning and mistakes. Regardless of your word count, take the moment to enjoy the process, the break, and don't be afraid to lift rocks or write something else, to shake a few things loose and discover something you weren't expecting. One thing that I have learned is that I need multiple projects going at once, and I have to be working on something at all times. My mind, part of my mind, has to just be whirling around. So, but stories need rest. So whether you're reading them or writing them, really, so the more the merrier. Although, you know, it's always good to judge what you know, your level. Tell yourself, nope, I'm cutting it off here. I can't take on anymore. That's a hard thing for some of us in all areas of life, especially at this time of year. Before Thanksgiving break, I finished reading Everything That's Underneath by Christy DeMeester, which is a splendid collection of her horror and weird fiction. Each story is a complex and haunting masterpiece. The title of the collection is the title of the first story, which really sets the groundwork and mood perfectly for the rest, the stories to follow. And Christie's lyrical style and just tints of sorrow just touched, the sorrow touched scenes bled together in just a mystifying air that builds just with each story. The wicked shall come upon him and worship only when she bleeds. Were not only two of my favorites of the collection, but each story it'll stick with me for a while. and a lot of them have that effect, that lingering, like, oh, and they come around, they get you and they come around again. So definitely check out this anthology. It is out through Apex Book Company, so you can go to their site, go to all sorts of places where books are sold, and pick it up, because it is truly great. And in general, Apex Book Company has so many awesome and intriguing titles. So if you're not familiar, definitely go on the site and see what they have. And my full review of Everything That's Underneath will be on jamiethescribbler.com and tmwpod.com Friday the 1st and of December. that pretty much sums up my end. I will be rambling a lot more for you next week for a new kind of episode to mix it up a bit for the crazy month of December. And if you haven't already, hop over to patreon.com/too many words to support the show and gain access to fun exclusives like short stories and other exclusive audio and written content. So, and all the Patreon tiers are inspired and named after my pets. So head over there and check it out. And without further ado, let's go to my talk with Fran Wild.
Your Bone Universe is just, it's one of my favorite worlds that I've got to visit.
Oh, wow. Do you have a favorite character?
I do. Nat is my favorite.
Really? Oh yes. My gosh. Yes, Team Nat. I have, there are definitely different camps for who people love more. And there's a huge contingent of Kirit fans. And Nat is, I really empathize with him and I really like him, but he was kind of a butthead to start off with. So it's really, I think, harder for people to understand why his point of view is important. I'm just rambling here, but I'm just so delighted that you like him.
He stood out to me as just a very, he's a very complex character, but very unique. And I really like to, I gravitate towards those characters who aren't, I would say the fan favorite.
Flawed characters, just like flawed people, are really much more interesting in some ways.
I agree. I really like, I like the underdogs and the anti-heroes and the less obvious hero choice.
Tell me what you like about Nat. I know you're supposed to be interviewing me, but I'm totally going to interview you. Hello, all Jamie people. I'm Fran, and I'm totally interviewing Jamie right now.
Awesome. I really like how, he has just a strong moral code, and he grows throughout the trilogy, but he sticks to his core in a way that anytime he makes a decision, I feel like, okay, that was what Nat was supposed to do.
That really means a lot to hear that from you. Thank you.
And, as far as, and don't get me wrong, I love Kirit too. Mm-hmm. Their relationship also adds a lot to why I like Nat, because it gives him that, he has this moral code and he has this complicated relationship, with Kirit, but he's still, you know, he just stays so true to himself and his beliefs, you know, despite that. And I think that's great.
He has sort of a core of confidence to him that Curate makes up for with brashness in a way. Like Curate is very goal oriented. If you put something that Curate wants behind, you know, a wall, she'll go through the wall to get it. And that's much more cerebral in a way. And in that, I think he's very sweet, but I think it's a slower pace too. It's much more, he would be the archaeologist or the forensic guy or the, you know, somebody who wants to do the right thing and isn't necessarily sure how.
Yes. Yes. And that all comes through. And, so how did, you know, these characters end up in this universe? Did the universe come to you before the characters did, or was it the characters?
It's interesting because the world came to me about 1 o'clock in the morning during a writing challenge at a writer's workshop. The writer's workshop is Viable Paradise, which is a great workshop for long and short novels and short stories. You can find Viable Paradise at viableparadise.com. And there are great instructors that are happy to talk about writing speculative fiction and fantasy, short stories, novels, everything. And I got a challenge to write, you know, a story in 24 hours for a made up magazine. And there were certain parameters that were given to me. And I went back to my computer and decided I knew exactly what I was going to be writing about. I was going to write a story about a Mechanical Turk. And I love automatons. There is one in Philadelphia that I visit as often as I can in the Franklin Institute called the Maillardé Automaton, which is the basis for Hugo Cabret. And you wind it up and it will draw 7 different drawings for you. I think 7. And they're the most intricate, beautiful things you've ever seen. And it moves beautifully. And it's all gears. It's all mechanical stuff. And so I took a look at the parameters for this. This is a very long story. I took a look at the parameters for this assignment and said, I'm going to write, it was about megacities. I was supposed to be writing a story about a megacity. And I thought, I'm going to write a story about a megacity that's driven by a Mechanical Turk, which is an automaton that is actually more of a Wizard of Oz, Great and Powerful Oz thing, where you pull the curtain back and there's actually somebody hiding under the table. And so I had the story all written, and I was dealing with some chronic pain at the time, so I didn't go out to town with a whole bunch of people. So I sat and I had dinner alone, and I thought about my story. And then eventually I realized pretty late into the evening, and the story was due at like 10 or 11 the next morning, that's not what I wanted to be writing about at all. I wanted to write about an organic city. And I sat down, threw everything out. I threw out about 2,000 words and wrote a story about 2 characters who were flying in between towers of living bone high above the clouds. So the world really came to me then, and sort of one of those freak moments where the inspiration fairy is up on far too much coffee and has sort of, you know, met you halfway. And I was fascinated with the world, but I was also, I had just come off an argument with one of the instructors, not really an argument, but it's more of a debate about Milton and Paradise Lost. It was Stephen Bruce, and he'd written a book called Terrain in Hell, which is from the point of Morningstar or Satan. And so we've been talking about it a little bit, and I decided to name my 2 characters. Milton was one of them, and John, DJONN, was the other character. All 27 people who read that story that next day when I turned it in knew how Cloudbound ended for about 5 years. And they kept the secret beautifully. Because what I had then was I had the parameters of the world. I had the up and down scope of the world. I didn't have the horizon scope, but I knew where the arc of that part of the story was going. But I hadn't found my characters yet. John, DJONN, not John Jalen, appears in a short story, probably one of the first short stories I finished in that world, which is called A Moment of Gravity Circumscribed. And you can find that on Lightspeed. And then he appears again in Cloudbound and Horizon. But he wasn't the character that was speaking to me most at first. I knew why I wanted him there. I wanted a character with a variation on adult onset scoliosis, which is something I know very well, because that makes it very difficult to fly. And I wanted to expand on that further. But the voices that I was hearing as I started writing more short stories in the world, which is sort of how I block out where I kind of want to explore in a big world like this, I start writing short stories first. And the voices that I was hearing were two characters who were arguing for the right to speak. They were actually fighting for the right to speak by having an armed wing fight in a wind tunnel. And those two were Kirit and Nat. And wow. That was the second short story that I wrote. I wrote it for, I was trying to hit a market, which they tell you never to do, but I had sort of wanted to break into Beneath Ceaseless Skies. And I thought, well, I'll write a story set in one of the towers and I'll make it one of the stranger towers. And when I started thinking about the dimensions of the city and how bone towers grow, I realized that a deformed tower with the wall on the outside instead of the core on the inside would be a natural wind tunnel. It would also be a fortress. And that sort of gave rise to the singers who would be living in that and sort of have a different worldview from everybody else. And when I wrote this short story, I brought it to my critique group, which was mostly Viable Paradise graduates. It was a year on. And I said, hooray, I've written a short story in this world, and here it is. And they all looked at me and said, so we've got this good news and bad news. This is good, but it's not a short story. It's a novel. And we have all these questions. And as they went through the questions, I realized I had questions too, as far as like what kind of society would expect of its people a sort of battle in order to find out the truth, in order to be able to ask a question or speak about something. So I started just rewriting, again, doing little sketches for different characters. And almost immediately I realized that either Kirit or Nat could be the lead for the story. Each of their stories was of interest to me. They both had lost things. They both had stuff to gain. And it was really who I heard loudest and strongest first. And of course, that was Kirit because she's loud. But she was also fighting with her mom. And that's how I wrote the first scene for Updraft, pretty much stream of consciousness. The original first line for the book was, on a morning like this, fear is a blue sky emptied of birds. And that line stayed with the book for every draft. It just kind of moved down in the opening scene for the book. It was something that gave me the opportunity to explore different characters' voices while building a world and while looking at what two very different first-person perspectives and two very different worldviews would do to how you saw a secondary world. Because they each see vastly different things about the world. And when they come together in Horizon and you see them experiencing similar things from completely different perspectives, it's really, that was what I had been hoping to be able to do with the conclusion of the series all along, was to show that it's not just one perspective on the world that's important, it's just lots of different ones, and having them sort of combine into a broader view by virtue of placing them side by side and giving them still the right to speak was important.
Well, and I loved how all that came together. It must have been challenging, though, or at least, you know, I was thinking about that, like writing the different perspectives and keeping true to each perspective in a world so complex. That must have been challenging at times.
It was really hard. I had, I did a lot of drafts. I actually wrote Cloudbound twice, once from Kirit's perspective, and Kirit didn't want to do it at all, because this where Updraft is a story about voice and finding your voice and who gets to speak. Cloudbound is really a story about leadership and who should lead and how to lead once things have happened so that the original leadership is gone, and who really shouldn't lead ever. And that is not Kirit. Kirit's not a leader. She's a hero, but she's not a leader. And I think that Nat could have been the hero of the first book as well, just a very different one. And I think that his arc is the much more traditional hero's journey arc. You go from, you know, fighting in the tower and discovering all these things and then becoming leader. That's the traditional one. Kirit's the one that turns away from a lot of that. Bringing the voices together and making sure that Nat and Kirit had completely different cadences and they use different phrasing. Kirit can become a little bit more lyrical. She has that sense of the sound of things, how things should sound and flow, and she's got a really good wind sense. So she kind of hears the wind whistling through everything. And Nat is much more terse and much more shorter sentences and not as much descriptive eloquence in his thoughts, but he's a warrior, so you get more questions. And then bringing that together into the third book and having to tell the arc of that narrative over, there's actually three main perspectives, first person point of view, and then there's a secret fourth, and making sure that all of those voices were distinct basically meant that the first go around, I wrote each character's story separately and then wove them together. And then my editor, Miriam Weinberg at Tor, was wonderful in sort of helping me pinpoint places that I could tighten the voice and bring things up. And there were a couple of times where I realized that I had one character sort of slipping into the scene because they really wanted to be in that scene, and I would shift things around so that they could be. But it was fun. And just giving the idea of the progression of song throughout the trilogy, where in Updrafts, singing is a way to memorize and remind people of what is traditional and what is, you know, these are the things that are done. And in Cloudbound, singing is something to be played with. So you play with tradition and you mess with it a little bit. And then in Horizon, singing is much more a way to transfer information quickly so that people will remember it, but it's all new information. So the song that appears in Horizon is a way to get people moving. And the person who is writing that song is the person who has been sort of in charge of the song through the whole series. It just
I loved that. I gotta say, I'm pretty tickled to hear that you wrote Cloudbound with Kirik's perspective and then rewrote it. I'm in a massive rewrite right now where I'm going from first person to third person because I need third person to really tell the story that I want to tell, the one that needs to be told. And I'm about halfway through that rewrite right now. So anytime I hear of other people's massive rewrites, I'm just like, okay.
I threw out almost 100,000 words. And rewrote it. And because Kirit's experience in Cloudbound is very different than Nat's experience. So they split already and their narrative arcs are completely different. So I had to completely rewrite not just scenes, but whole chapters and whole plot lines. And that was painful. I wish I hadn't had to do it, but I also learned so much in the doing of it that I was going, because what was important to Nat in Cloudbound was absolutely not important to Kirit. She was very clear about that. But also,
yeah, so just having to pull out those, you know, those different beats.
The main arc of the story was I knew we were going down from the minute I started Cloudbound. I knew it was going to be a deep dive into the history of the world and the community, and showing what they had lost on the way up was very important. But it was also about, you know, facing your past and coming to terms with the knowledge that everything might not be as you had come to believe it. So those things were definitely much more evocative from Nat's perspective, because Nat is so sure he knows what's going on the whole time, and he finds out a lot of things that alter his worldview, and that was really fun. But I wanted to talk to you about your point, because you said that you're shifting from first person point of view to third person. Did you find that really opened up your revision so that you like discovered new things as you were shifting perspective like that?
Yes, big time. Because I had written the entire thing in first person past tense. I went over it a bunch. Then I sent it to Kat Howard, and she sent it back to me.
Isn't she great?
She's amazing.
So wonderful.
She's just a delight. And she sent me back this edit, it's an amazing edit letter. And I spent a while chewing on that. And then when I hit revisions, I wasn't hitting a flow for what I needed to rewrite. And I'm like, what is going on? And then actually, I put it in a drawer for a second and started writing a short story in the same world. And then in third person. And I was just like, then everything just like, I was like, okay. And then I was just, I'm discovering just all these gems. And it's like, oh, okay, yeah, totally freed me up. It's pretty fun.
The things that your subconscious knew that you're, while you're trying to maintain sort of enough control to get to the end of the book in that first draft. And then you go back and you're like, oh, I did put that there. Oh, wow, that was so great. And just sort of unfolding it. Mm-hmm. Is part of the revision process. And you want it to be perfect the first time you set it down, but it's never going to be perfect that first time.
Just accepting that helps, because very early on I expected my drafts to be perfect and not the hot mess that they were. But it's also like, with what you were talking about, with your process of Updraft and Cloudbound and Horizon, it's a lot of just trusting like these gut feelings. And it's, it's really important to be able to be like, okay, my brain's actually telling me I need to do it this way. But it can be so hard to trust that.
It's hard to trust. I mean, especially when you're holding an entire world in your head or an entire plot arc in your head, sometimes it feels very out of control. And letting that story be out of control for a little bit is as important sometimes as having your word count and the place where you write and all the things organized. There's definitely a friction between the two, and I think especially for writers who starting this process for the first time or starting a new type of book for the first time, that can be really scary, because it's, what if this won't work? What if I'm wasting my time? And the thing that I came away from both Viable Paradise and Palace Toolbox, which is another great writer's workshop in Santa Fe, New Mexico, is that nothing is ever lost. Mm-hmm. When you make a creative effort towards something or creative move towards something, it's going to be there in some way in the final product, or like what you did in a short story. You can take that creative direction to lots of different projects. It's not going to be lost. It's not going to be wrong. You're not going to have wasted any time. You're just evolving it into something different. Even if you have to go in and toss out basically a whole book and start over again to do it.
Like you said, there is, even if the words themselves are words that you can't keep, they help pave the path for words that you need. I can't even, well, actually, in my current project, I have a character that I created like 13 years ago and decided never to use. And then here she was demanding this story. So
that's great. I mean, that's when they come back up and they're like, hi, I go in here, then, or when they are actively resisting your plot line and basically every other word out of their mouth on the page is stupid or dumb or boring, then you realize that you have not only created a character that is capable of standing up to you, but also acting on their own in the plot, which is also something that means you've actually created a three-dimensional character and not just sort of a paper doll that you're moving around. It's something, if your character has wants and needs and you forget about them and they put the brakes on the story and everything, like all the writing gets really hard all of a sudden, you give them a little time to run around and do what they want, and all of a sudden you realize they have a better idea about the plot than your author brain does.
Yes. It's such a, I mean, and I can just spend time just thinking about the mind all on its own, you know, like how you have all these different folds and like the subconscious, and just learning to lean into it and when to not lean into it, or why it's become difficult all of a sudden. It's really interesting. It's like a craft all in itself. It's like the craft in order to craft.
Definitely. And then letting that go at the end of a project, which is something we were talking about before we started recording, which I thought was really interesting, because you get so wound up in the world and you get so wound up in the characters' voices, and then the project comes to an end. You finish the book, or you finish the trilogy, or you finish the short story, because they all take the same amount of character building work often.
Yeah.
And no. Then you're done. And suddenly you don't, you need to move on and leave this group of trusted friends behind in a way. And it's difficult. It's kind of, it's sad in a way. It's hard.
It is. It's very difficult. Well, I mean, because like you said, you have so much focus and passion and, you know, the right amount. You need to be obsessed in some, you know, way in order to do this. So then,
you need to be living their lives. Like there was a point, I guess I was writing Cloudbound, and no, I was working on the first draft of Horizon, and I was copy editing Cloudbound at the same time, which was a hilarious kind of
thing in my life.
And I hadn't moved all day. I literally gotten up and gotten an apple for lunch and some cheese because I needed some protein. And then I came back and I sat. And when I was finished with the whole process, I'd written two battle scenes and copy edited a third, and I was exhausted. And I thought, why am I so tired? All I did was sit. And then I realized I had, you know, scaled a wall. I had fought off a monster. I had done all these things in my brain, and the muscles were tensing and releasing as I was writing. And it is exhausting. It's just exhausting in your head instead of exhausting physically.
Yes. Well, it is. That is an interesting thing, is because you do, like you said, I love that. I did fight a monster and climb a tower. It does go there. And it's like, yeah, before we took a break for Thanksgiving, I had spent, like, I didn't get off out of the chair for like 8 hours. And I was like totally in these scenes and everything else. Like, I picked my head up. It was time to, like, you know, be a mom. And I realized how messy my house was. I was like, well, what did I do? And I was just like, oh, well, you know, traveling, you know, by mount is exhausting.
Yeah. Kicking some monster butt along the way is really hard. You know, people should understand why dinner isn't ready at 5:30. I think, too, there is this, there is a definite exhaustion to sitting still. And I have actually started setting a timer so that, and I know a lot of writers do this, so that they get up, they get a glass of water, they get a little protein. When I'm in a writing fugue, I definitely forget to do those things. So taking some time to take care of yourself is also important. Set a timer and set a little note, you know, in your calendar or something that says, have you gotten up lately? Have you stretched? That's important too.
It is true. And it's funny that it really is something that you have to pay attention to. Like, oh no, you're staring at the screen, not because you're blocked. You desperately need an apple.
Yep. There's a point where more than a few of my characters start drinking coffee in the afternoon. And I thought, okay, that's a sign.
Yeah, when I realize I spend like 500 words describing what they're eating, it's like, okay, get some lunch, Jamie, would you?
Yeah, I mean, but that's important too, because you can get so caught up with all of the exciting parts that the downtime in a narrative is sometimes left to the side. And that's something that has always interested me. When I started the podcast that I've been doing for some time, one of our mottos was no character starts today, because we wanted to talk about the act of cooking and the politics of food and how things worked in science fiction and fantasy to allow for more than just what Diana Wynne Jones talked about when she talked about stew, that sort of brown glop that has no nutritive value. So it's really great to hear that you'd spend 500 words on food, because I mean, characters get hungry just like authors get hungry.
It's true. Well, and food itself, I mean, you know, it's something that brings us together. It's something that's very different depending on what your culture is. And, you know,
absolutely.
You know, Thanksgiving was just the other day. A whole bunch of people had turkey. And it also, it really opens up, actually. And I found this when I was really trying to figure out, you know, where my characters were. It's where they are depends on, you know, what food they can have, what they're cooking, what they're using. It's definitely something that you can use to just expand the world a little bit.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I would imagine, as far as, you know, you have these characters that have these elaborate constructed wings, you had to do some research there, I would imagine, to make them come across as something that's so real. I mean, I thought of hang gliding a couple of times, although it was very different than, you know, the hang gliding we're used to.
Yeah. Well, the wings furl, and they're manipulated by finger control. So they're much more tightly commanded. And I envision them as almost like the wingsuit flyers, but with a frame, and something that could work on a bigger scale. I did a lot of research into sort of the physics of flight and the history of flying. It turns out that as human beings, we have about 2,000 years of history of trying to fly without an engine or without assistance.
Oh, wow.
We're very bad at it. There's a lot of stories of people going up to the tops of towers in Londinium and in 11th century BC Britain and jumping off the tower and quote unquote flying, which actually is more like falling. And then breaking one or both legs or, you know, serious back injury, but they flew for 250 feet, which is approximately the distance of, you know, an angle of falling from a tower with a little bit of glide. And what I discovered in that research was that for the most part, with one or two distinct differences, most people did the wings bit, but they forgot to pick their feet up. So the idea of a wing skirt that lifted your feet as you went and your wings unfurled was really important. And that was directly from research. I put everything past several engineering consultants, one of whom I'm related to. And that's always pretty complicated because I have a lot of engineers in my family. And I knew that if I got the engineering bits wrong, I was going to hear about it. So I really tried to send that information past the engineers several times through just to make sure that I got it right. I wanted to get the flying right. I'm a sailor. I'm not a pilot. And I didn't want it to be a piloting thing. I wanted it to be much more closer to hang gliding or wingsuit flying. And I spent an awful lot of time on YouTube watching the wingsuit flyers because they're amazing. But what I wanted to make sure was that I hadn't just taken a sail and turned it sideways. I wanted to actually use the physics of flying. So in addition, and this is sort of before it became a popular thing, I went and did indoor skydiving at the place where the West Point cadets train to do skydiving. So I got to watch them train, and then I got to get in this big wind tunnel and sort of experience what it must have felt like in the spire a little bit without people shooting arrows and trying to kill you. And that was really fun.
Yeah.
So, and now you can do that. It seems like you can do that at like a lot of different places on the East and West Coast.
Interesting.
Yeah, there's a lot of indoor skydiving places popping up. And there are some really cool sports now. People have been sending me links to sort of the wind tunnel dancers and things. And those look amazing.
Indoor skydiving I could do. I couldn't jump out of a plane.
Nope. You would have to cut off my hands because my hands would be deathlocked around the plane and would never, ever come away. Nope. Yeah. Not going to happen.
Well, I think I could have.
I know a lot of people who have done it and loved it. And that is not me. I have way too much ability to imagine way too many things happening. So
sometimes just going to the grocery store is tough for that reason.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like I can think of 12 different scenarios how this can go, how this can go.
Yeah. Yep. I was a scuba diver. I got my PADI certification back when I was much younger, and I stopped scuba diving when I started my family because I just felt like, you know, it's not something that I want to be doing while I have somebody in the world that needs me as much as a child does. So I haven't been scuba diving in a long time either, but I love doing that. I just love being completely underwater and in this very different world.
Being underwater does feel like that. You're just, yeah. But yeah, no, I mean, I used to enjoy driving really fast, but then I became a mom. Now it's like, yeah. I've got people behind me like, please go over the speed limit at least a little bit. I'm like, no.
Yeah, that's hard.
Mm-hmm.
It is hard. It's you know, being able to imagine outcomes and plot arcs is advantageous, but it's also, it definitely feeds a lot of extra planning expeditions that the brain probably doesn't need to go on.
So what do you have in coming out? I know that you recently signed a new deal.
I am working on the second and third novellas in the GEM universe, which the first book was The Jewel in Her Lapidary, which came out in 2016.
It was a beautiful story. I love it. I'm really excited that there's going to be more.
There's going to be more. One of the characters is coming back in a vastly changed form. The second book in the second novella is way in the future, and technology has started to come into the world, and there's a lot of there's a lot of shenanigans that go on, but it's essentially, there are no gems left, or possibly there are a few, but they're in hiding, and so this is the discovery of one of the gems and its magical capabilities. The characters in this one are setting off to save the world in a much, much different way than the characters in The Jewel in Her Lapidary, which was...
That's exciting.
Yeah. I mean, it was a story for The Jewel in Her Lapidary. It was a story about sort of finding your inner strength in a way that you hadn't been trained from birth to do, which was also about leadership. I think you're right about leadership a lot, but you know, not, it's more like stumbling towards leadership than it is like, this is how to lead. And this book is much more, I've been joking about it a little bit and talking about it as sort of a battle between a clock, a timepiece, and a printing press.
Ooh.
And so it's a cage match between those two. It is in the stages where I have a bit of revising ahead of me, but I'm really excited about the characters, and I'm excited about the world as it's developed, and I'm looking forward to sharing that with everybody.
That's awesome. And when is that set to release?
I think next year is what we're shooting for. It's awesome. You know, publishing. So yep. Everything being equal and all things being good, hopefully next in 2018.
It is a long game, isn't it?
It is, and it's something that, you know, when we were talking about before, just when you finish a trilogy, you kind of look up and go, wow, that was amazing. What year is it? And I'm definitely having that feeling now. I'm not quite sure which year I'm in, but I know that, you know, 2018 and 2019 are hopefully going to be great, because 2017 was really kind of tough.
Yeah.
For a lot of different reasons.
It was a tough one. I was thinking about that as I was reading Horizon. I was thinking about it as a writer. Like, yeah, you have the trilogy out. That's something. It's both exciting and strange feeling.
And yet, as a, you know, as a writer, you finish this thing and you're like, yes, this is an accomplishment. This is great. I am going to be very pleased with myself for about 10 minutes, and then I'm going to start wondering what I do next.
Yes.
And that's, you know, that is both a blessing and it's a curse, because sort of taking the moment to celebrate the accomplishment is not something that I'm very good at. And I'm working on trying to do that a bit more, because
it was a
very long journey. Lots of people put in, you know, so much time to make sure that these books were made and that they were made well and beautifully. Tommy Arnold, who did the covers for all three books, is just amazing, and I love the covers that he did. Irene Gallo, who is the creative director at Tor, my editor, Miriam Weinberg, everybody just put in so much effort to make these books as strong as they could possibly be. And it is a village project to get a trilogy out and into the world, especially in 3 years. And I just feel very lucky for the experience, and I feel very lucky to have been able to work with everybody involved in the project.
That's awesome. Yeah, I'm with you on I'm also trying to be like, take the moment and be like, okay, well, you did a good job. So just appreciate that, revel in it a little bit.
It's so hard.
It's so hard.
There's always something more that you want to do after.
Could you tell everybody where they can find you on Twitter and otherwise?
Absolutely. I am taking a tiny little bit of a Twitter hiatus. I'm sort of on, and I occasionally go on to, you know, check in with people, but mostly it's been pictures that I've been cross-posting from Instagram. So Twitter, I am Fran_Wild. And Instagram, I'm Fran_Wild. I'm on Pinterest. I have some boards that relate to inspiration from the world that are up on my Pinterest boards. I think I'm Fran_Wild there. So I try to keep it pretty uniform. I have a newsletter that you can access by going to franwild.net, and FRANWILDE.net. I have a blog that is accessible from the website as well. And for the most part, that is where Kuzina Books, the podcast, lives, which is a podcast that I co-host with my friend Elliot Bodart. And we also host a little bit over on The Book Smugglers, which is they are lovely, fabulous people, and I feel very, very lucky to work with them. So you can find me a lot of places like that. You can find me at Fran Wild Writes on Facebook. That's my author page. And I try to keep everything updated so that there are appearance calendars and everybody knows where I am. But the easiest way to stay up to date is sign up for newsletters and check out the website and subscribe to the posting calendar so that when I do actually put up another blog post, you get an email.
Awesome. Well, Fran, thank you so much for coming on. It was so much fun having you.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been a really wonderful conversation.
Glad to hear it.
So Twitter, I am Fran_Wild. And Instagram, I'm Fran_Wild. I'm on Pinterest. I have some boards that relate to inspiration from the world that are up on my Pinterest boards. I think I'm Fran_Wild there. So I try to keep it pretty uniform. I have a newsletter that you can access by going to franwild.net, and FRANWILDE.net. I have a blog that is accessible from the website as well. And for the most part, that is where Kazina Books, the podcast, lives, which is a podcast that I co-host with my friend Aliette de Baudard. And we also host a little bit over on the Book Smugglers, which is they are lovely, fabulous people, and I feel very, very lucky to work with them. So you can find me a lot of places like that. You can find me at Fran Wild Writes on Facebook. That's my author page. And I try to keep everything updated so that there are appearance calendars and everybody knows where I am. But the easiest way to stay up to date is sign up for newsletters and check out the website and subscribe to the posting calendar so that when I do actually put up another blog post, you get an email.
Awesome. Well, Fran, thank you so much for coming on. It was so much fun having you.
Thank you so much for having me. This has been a really wonderful conversation.
Glad to hear it.
All right, guys, that wraps it up for this week. Big thanks to Fran for coming on the show. Be sure to tune in next week for what I'm calling Interlude 1. You can follow the show on Twitter at Too Many Words Pod and me at Me Bedingfield, and to my site for everything else, tmwpod.com. Go to patreon.com/too many words and support the show. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll talk to you next week.